After a good spread, it's always a good idea to clean off your Dominator.
Well, good afternoon, my friends, and welcome back to another crazy, zany episode of The Lawn Care Nut. Today's topic is all about growing grass from seed. Let's not waste any more time. Let's get right out to the lawn.
What's up, y'all? I'm Alan Hain, the Lawn Care Nut. Thanks for coming back for yet another week.
I will link to the video I did just a couple days ago that shows how we arrived at this point with Frankenlawn, and I will end up turning this into a complete playlist.
So for those of you who aren't looking for a long-term YouTube commitment and you're here just for the tip, I'll link in the description below where you can find the meat of this video. But for the rest of you, I want to thank you.
A bunch of y'all pointed out that what I should do is get a cover plate for this clean out here, similar to the one, this is my clean out, right? And this has a cover plate on it. Well, I should get one for that too.
And that's why this channel is so great. Not because of me, but because of you guys. Something so obvious that I should have figured out and I didn't, and you guys reminded me of it. In fact, even Cousin Danny texted me saying, Al, get a cover plate, bro.
And that's also probably why they did leave this recessed a good 3 inches below grade, because I told them, hey, that's it. I want you to leave. Don't do any more. But if they would have stayed, they probably would have fixed the lawn, and then they would have put a grade on it. But because I told them to leave, now it's up to me.
Well, this is what I ended up getting. This is actually for irrigation. Supposed to put, you know, access for irrigation valves and stuff underneath it. But hey, that was what was available to me. And, as our friend AVE often says, sometimes you gotta dance with the girl that brung you.
Alright, so how to grow grass seed. Now this video will work no matter where you live, north, south, east, west, even overseas. If you're growing grass seed, these techniques will work for you. The only thing that's going to vary is obviously the current weather where you are and the tolerance that the seed and the grass type that you're planting has for that weather. And speaking of weather, let's talk about that right now, because that's the very first thing that you need to consider when you're trying to grow grass seed is what are the temperatures like? But let's define that first. So there's a lot of different things to consider when you're thinking about the temperature. The first obviously is the soil temperature, because that's really where the literal rubber meets the road, or as you're going to find out later, where the seed meets the soil.
So these are ideal temperatures. You can go up or down as much as you want and take a risk at any time. But as a rule, the closer you can get to this target window, the better results you're gonna have. The other thing to keep in mind is that all these grass types can germinate at much higher temperatures, 70s, even 80s. Bermuda, probably even up to 100, but that would mean growing in the summer, and that's probably not the best idea. Let's try to limit things to the spring and fall, with late summer to early fall being the ideal and perfect window for cool season grass, and mid to later spring being the ideal or perfect window for the warm season grass like the Bermuda I'm planting here.
Now, outside temperatures matter too, because outside temperatures, lows and highs, nights and days, are indicative of where the soil temperature is going or may be going. Now, we could talk all day about temperatures and the ideal temperatures and times to seed, and I would never answer every single question because there's always a different scenario. Just use your head, right? What is the season you're in, and are the temperatures going to trend up because it's spring going into summer, or are the temperatures going to trend down because you're in late summer, early fall heading into winter? You just need to use a little bit of logic and understand what the normal weather patterns are in your area when you're looking for a perfect seeding window. All right, so next let's talk about seed to soil contact.
All right, so I obviously have a giant bare spot, so it's pretty easy for me to get seed to soil contact. But the reason it's so important,
there are two reasons why seed-soil contact is important. The first one is that when the seed is covered, at least on one side, but ideally on both sides by soil, that helps to retain heat and moisture, which are both vital for the seed to germinate and grow. And secondly, and it should be obvious, once the seed grows, it's going to put down some roots, and those roots need something to get into, grab onto, and suck nutrients and moisture from.
Now, most grass seed these days comes with this green coating on it. You guys have probably noticed this. You pay a little bit more for that, but if you can get it and afford it, I recommend you do it.
The green coating is typically going to do two things. Number one, it's going to contain some nutrients, almost like a little bit of a starter fertilizer that's literally wrapped to the hull of the seed, or if it's unhulled seed, wrapped to the seed itself. But either way, it's going to provide a little bit of nutrient value, and that's a good thing. The second thing, though, is it kind of simulates or mimics seed-to-soil contact, because whatever the stuff is that's surrounding the seed there absorbs and holds water very well and will actually expand a little bit when it gets wet. And will actually expand a little bit when it gets wet, which again hugs that seed in a nice warm coating of wet goo, stuff that it just loves.
Now, one thing I'll tell you though is this is really going to be a huge help if you're overseeding an existing lawn. Like up north, if you're doing an aeration and overseeding, this seed's really going to help you. But when it comes to a bare area like we're doing, it's going to help us, but I'm going to still institute some other measures to help hedge our bets. And that's why I always recommend some seed starter mulch.
Now, there's a lot of you guys that are on my coaching program. I'll link in that to the description below. If you want some personalized lawn coaching, I do that over on Patreon. But those of you that are over there that have had to do seeding, you know in the past, I've always recommended that you use some sort of something to make your seeds stick and hold so it doesn't wash away. And what I've always recommended is Scotch Patchmaster, just because it's readily available and easy to get, and it does contain some pretty good quality grass seed already in most cases. Little secret, by the way, when I worked for True Green, we did used to damage a few lawns here and there, and I was always the guy in operations that volunteered to go do the patchwork because I enjoyed doing it, and my secret was Scotch Patchmaster. Good thing that True Green and Scotch are combined nowadays. I'm sure that's fine, but back then, that was like sleeping with the enemy. So before we go getting too crazy with a bunch of seed coverings and stuff, because we're going to talk extensively about that, let's go ahead and get our seed down. And remember, like I've always told you, seed is cheap, so throw her down.
By the way, people ask a lot about rocks. Yeah, anything that size, get it out of there. Anything this size though, if it's spread several inches apart, that's not going to hurt anything.
So for example, you can see here, I got a piece of a seashell, welcome to Florida, rock, you know. That one I'd probably pull out, small ones like this, but you can kind of see how the spread is here. That's not gonna hurt anything at all. Anything more dense than that, go ahead and thin it out a little bit before you put your seed down. See here how this is kind of crusted over? This is from rain coming in. It's a crust. It's not really the worst thing with sand, but you still want to rough it up and scarify it like you see I've done here, just to loosen everything up. But with clay soil, this is really important. That crust that develops on there can get hard like cement, so you definitely want to break that crust up if you have clay soil. So inevitably, your next question is, well, Alan, how much grass seed do I throw down? And this is why I've always said, grass seed is cheap, so throw her down. Now, because some of you take me so literally, when I say grass seed is cheap, I don't mean it's literally cheap. But it is inexpensive when compared to the alternative of not succeeding because you don't put enough down and then having to start completely over. That's an expensive way to go. So when you're looking at it that way, grass seed's cheap, throw her down. And of course, when you compare it to other means like sodding, it's definitely cheaper. Back when I was in the Air Force, I don't know if you guys know or not, but I was a photojournalist, and there was a senior airman named John Pavliga that really taught me a lot about photography and how to take good pictures. And what he said was, Alan, film is cheap, so use a lot. And what he meant was, Using a lot of film is fine. You're gonna waste a ton of pictures, but you're gonna get that one perfect one when the general is smiling and saluting just perfectly, and you don't wanna miss that. So film is cheap. Use it up to make sure you get the right shot at the right time. And that's pretty much how I feel about grass seed. If you're gonna throw down more than you think, and I always say that, buy more than you think you need. For example, this little spot right here, I put down 5 pounds. So I'm gonna show you the density here, but don't panic.
So this is way more dense than what you're gonna read in any textbook or you're gonna read in anywhere else online, right? Way more dense, that's a technical term, way more dense. But you're gonna see, we're gonna rake this in and it's not gonna look quite so daunting. Let's just say you got a 50% germination rate out of this, which would be, by the way, guys, phenomenal. If you got 50% germination out of this, that means half of this is not gonna germinate. So that's why I kinda say, put it down. Throw it down heavy and let Mother Nature sort it out.
All right, next, rake it in. Lightly.
All right, next, let's talk about this seed mulch stuff. I'm gonna stand up because this is a really uncomfortable position, even though I think it's probably a pretty cool camera angle. Probably shows the garbage cans behind me too, you know, because I always care about that stuff.
Oh God.
So why do I recommend these sticky mulches? All right, now that we're back to it, why do I recommend that you use these sticky mulch seed starters? It's not because of the fertilizer in it or the seed starter in it or anything like that, and don't worry, you're not gonna overdo it. Just ignore the fact that it has fertilizer in it and just let that do its thing.
The reason that I want that is because of areas like this. Now we're gonna use it everywhere to hold the seed, to keep it sticky, to keep it in. It'll also help retain moisture. But the real reason I want it is for areas like this. So I don't know if you can tell, but there's a slope right here, right? And I got seed in there. And what'll happen is when I throw my sprinkler over there and it's squirting water this way, chuck, 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 right? It's gonna splash and it's gonna send any seed that's here. It's just gonna wash it right down in here into the street where it's not gonna grow and it's gonna be a waste.
And we're gonna use as little as possible. The key here is a super, super thin layer, because if this stuff gets too thick, it'll actually do the opposite and it will choke your seed out. So keep it thin. So this is not a case of throw her down. This is a case of reel it in and keep it thin, baby. As I get down in here, I think you can see, here's the pellets here. You can see they're kind of next to each other. There's one there, there, but they're not stacked up upon one another. If you get, and here's an area right here. See, like this area here, this is too thick. This is a low spot, so a lot congregate here. This is too thick. We need to spread this out. So get your hands in there and do that. Anything stacked up and it's gonna choke your seed out. Now the next step is optional. It's just gonna depend on what you got. With my space that I'm dealing with right here, I said my space. I'm gonna go ahead and put down some Milorganite because I can pretty much do an entire app because the rest of the grass there could use it anyway. And I'll just get a little bit to spill over and throw into the bare spot just to add a little bit of extra nutrients. Keep in mind, Milorganite is a slow release nitrogen, so it's not really gonna affect anything now. It's gonna be some nutrients that are in the soil a little bit later. It's also gonna help jumpstart soil biotic activity, and that's really what I'm putting it down for right now. Again, this is not a make or break. The seed coating itself, as well as the pellets you just put down, all have a little bit of fertilizer in them, enough to get things going. Now let's talk about watering. There's your initial watering and your ongoing watering. The initial watering I recommend being by hand so you can control where the water goes and watch what moves where, watch what shifts, watch what needs to be maybe hit again, watch what needs to be shored up with a little bit more sticky substance mulch. Whatever you're doing, do it by hand. This is also a way to connect with your new lawn, to let it know that you're going to give it that hands-on touch that it deserves, especially with the rebirth of a Frankenlawn.
The other thing this will do is it'll activate the green blue covering that's on the seed. Same thing it'll do. And I'd rather do this in an environment where I can control it rather than have a sprinkler, like I said before, just nailing it any old which way.
Now from here, I'm going to give this another good hand watering tonight and probably again tomorrow morning. And then I'm going to set up my sprinkler system so that it waters every day, twice a day. I guess if I was just to boil it down to you, you want to keep that area wet every single day, all hours of the day, for at least 25 to 30 days, depending on what type of grass you planted. The biggest mistake that people make is they stop watering too early, they get a big heat spell, and their new lawn dies. So when in doubt, keep watering.
You can already see the seed mulch is starting to expand just with that one watering, and it's gonna go even more. It's another reason why you don't want to put it on too heavy, because if those things are too close together, they'll literally grow together and on top of each other, making the layer way thicker than what you want. This looks pretty good though.
Lastly, it occurs to me that some of you might be wondering, Alan, why are you using this covering now instead of peat moss? I thought you were a peat moss guy. So I only use peat moss in the bigger jobs, 1,000, 1,500 square feet and bigger. Something small like this, I'm gonna go ahead and use something super sticky, again, just to hedge my bets, and because economically on an area this small, it's a good alternative. Alright guys, there you go. Thanks for watching all the way to the end of the video. I'm sure I didn't cover everything, even though I did try to be as thorough as possible here, so please leave your comments and questions below. As always, I'm Alan Hain, the Lawn Care Nut. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the lawn.